Karlsson, Karlsson, världens bästa Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, hoj här kommer Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, ingen faktiskt, ingen annan Karlsson spelar jag så bra som mig.
Karlsson, Karlsson, Karlsson scores!
Karlsson, Karlsson, världens bästa.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of the Keeping Karlsson Fantasy Hockey Podcast, the best fantasy hockey podcast in the world, hosted by two guys who own Eric Karlsson and their keeper pools. I am your host, Elan Dubrovsky, and I've got another fun beat writer interview for you today. I talked to David Shane from the Review Journal in Las Vegas all about the Vegas Golden Knights. It was a really fun chat. We went a bit long because there were a lot of players to talk about, and who's complaining, right? We really covered a lot of ground, and it was really fun. I think you're really going to like this interview. Before we get to that, of course, let me mention that we are presented by DauberHockey.com, which is the top fantasy hockey website in the whole entire world. I'm always over at Frozen Tools prepping for these episodes and doing my research for fantasy hockey. It's an invaluable resource. I feel like a lot of people don't even realize it outside of maybe Keeping Karlsson listeners, because I always mention it, but Frozen Tools is one of the best things out there. And then the actual site itself, Dauber Hockey, you've got great articles all the time, daily ramblings coming every single day from really smart people like Michael Clifford, Ian Gooding, you know, the whole team over there. So you definitely want to check it out and be up to speed with everything going on in fantasy over at DauberHockey.com. But with that, let's go to my interview with David Shane, all about the Vegas Golden Knights. Enjoy. Okay, everybody, really excited for this next interview. It's time to talk Vegas Golden Knights. And I've got a ringer here, Golden Knight reporter for the Las Vegas Review Journal, David Shane. David, welcome to the show.
Awesome to be on. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, I was really excited when you agreed to come on, because you are the man when it comes to tweeting about the Vegas Golden Knights. I'm excited to talk to you about them, because this team, you must have a fun job, right? I just talked to Alan Mitchell about the Edmonton Oilers, and that's a team that's only made the playoffs once since 2006. Meanwhile, Vegas started just three seasons ago, makes it to the Cup Finals in their first year. Then last year, it was looking like they were going to go on another run before Cody Eakin took that major penalty in the third period versus the Sharks, and that was all she wrote there. And then this year, year three, was looking as good as ever for the Golden Knights. At the time of the pause, they sat first in the Pacific, earning them a bye into the playoffs if this NHL return to play happens, which it does seem like it's going to happen according to how busy your day was today. Though actually, when you look closer, things weren't looking as good for Vegas all the way through the year. Like after losing 4-0 to Minnesota on February 11th, the team was tied for third in the Pacific with Calgary and Arizona. They were just a couple points away from being outside of the playoff picture. But after that game, a switch got flipped. Vegas was unstoppable for the next month. They won 11 of their remaining 13 games to secure that top spot in the division. Do you have any idea what changed in that final month that led Vegas to find that next gear and become such an unbeatable team? Like, did it have to do with Pete DeBoer taking over as the coach? Did he make any changes that contributed to this run?
Yeah, kind of all of the above, I think. I mean, to start with, obviously, they were a team that was expected to do well from the beginning. So it wasn't like they had an empty cupboard or anything like that. If anything, they were sort of underachieving, which may have cost Jared Glantz his job in essence. And I think it took a little bit for them to adjust to Pete DeBoer, and the systems weren't much different, but there were a few tweaks, a couple of significant things. The penalty kill especially is very different. It's basically like completely inverted in terms of where they're pressuring. They used to pressure really high up in the zone, and now they're kind of dropping back and they're really pressuring in the zone, things like that. That's a difference. There's a difference in the breakout if you watch really closely, where the center kind of swings back through the zone and things like that. But, I think really it was just more about getting the most out of a team that was supposed to be, really good and kind of a favorite in the Pacific Division to begin with. You know, it took a little bit, like I said, but I think they clicked. They made a couple deals. They got Alec Martinez in there. I think that solidified the blue line. Couple other, little things that we'll kind of talk about. We've got a whole lot of time to discuss. But yeah, I think there were a few things that maybe they just needed a kick in the butt, and that all sort of happened over the last month before the pause.
Yeah, you're right. Like, this team was looking good going into the year. I was surprised that they weren't like a strong team all the way through. When I started looking at what happened throughout, it's even more impressive, by the way, that they were winning so much at the end, because they didn't have Mark Stone for that final stretch of the year. He missed the final six games. And Mark Stone is one of these players, like, I find it so incredible. They made it to the Cup Finals in 2017-18. That was without Mark Stone. Like, they actually fully upgraded their second line following a year where they made it to the Cup Finals. They exchanged Haula, Neal, and Perron for Stastny, Stone, and Pacioretty. So that seems like a pretty nice upgrade. And while Pacioretty led the team in points this season, it was Mark Stone who had the highest point pace. His 63 points in 65 games, that was good for a 79.82 game pace. And like I said, his season got cut short at the end with a lower body injury, cost him the final six games of the year. I see you tweeted on June 12th saying that Stone has declared himself 100% healthy and ready to go. So that's good to hear. And yeah, I'm curious to know, like, Mark Stone, he seems like maybe an underrated player. Like, even though he put up a 79 point pace, which is elite, you don't hear people talk about him as like one of the great players in the league, even though he's like amazing possession wise, one of the best when it comes to takeaways and not having giveaways. So would it be hyperbole for me to say that Stone might be one of the more underrated players in the league? Like, I feel like Bergeron and Kopitar always brought up of examples of some of the best two way players, but I feel like Stone should be in that conversation.
Yeah, I think he started to get a little bit of that publicity and recognition last year. I think he was second in the Selke. And obviously, like, the takeaways are sort of the stat that everybody points to with him. In some ways, maybe the knock on him is that he's not a center. You know, all the guys that you kind of mentioned are centers, Bergeron, Kopitar. You know, I'm lucky enough to be a voter on the Selke Award and things like that. And you know, Couturier, guys that you always look for, Ryan O'Reilly, they're all centers. And Mark Stone, especially last year, was kind of the outlier a little bit in that. And I definitely think he got the recognition. But, you know, maybe playing in Ottawa, maybe, you know, maybe having good seasons, but maybe modest point totals until last year. You know, he'd never been over the 70-point mark. So I think it's more that he's kind of coming into his own. He's a little bit of a late bloomer. I mean, even going back to juniors and things like that, he wasn't a high draft pick. I mean, he was like a sixth-round pick. He took a little bit to kind of, you know, come into his own. Once he got to Ottawa, obviously he emerged pretty quickly. But, you know, it's sort of the trajectory maybe that he's been on his whole career. He's not a guy that, you know, came in with a whole bunch of buzz and had it right from the start. He's kind of earned it all the way along and things like that. Maybe playing in a, I guess, quote-unquote smaller market like Ottawa, maybe going to Vegas, being a guy who gets a, you know, an 8-year deal, a $9.5 million AAV, and all those sorts of things will sort of add to it. I think the things, to be quite honest, that really will boost his stock and started to really, you know, give him more of a name recognition, I guess you could say, was, you know, playing for Team Canada, representing them in the World Championships, doing well, doing in front of his country. And, you know, maybe with this new CBA and things like that, if he's still healthy and going toward, you know, 2022 and he's able to play for Team Canada, you know, then maybe that's when he'll really explode and people will see how good he is.
Yeah, and I guess you're right. Maybe this was like even an outdated question by me, because he did come second in that Selke voting. That's cool that you got to vote for it. So I assume Vegas is happy with this acquisition. They traded this prospect defenseman, Brandstrom, to get him. But Stone has been like as good as he could have been, maybe even better. So I'd imagine the team's very happy to have him, even with that big contract also.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, one of the things that's been interesting to see around here, to kind of hear around here, they have never named a captain. From day one, they've kind of always been a team that's held this 23 captains mantra and things like that. Nobody's worn a C, but it sort of feels like, you know, maybe everybody's waiting for Mark Stone to just kind of grab a hold of this team. And maybe at some point, he's the guy who emerges as a potential captain and the guy who wears a C going forward. He's got a long contract. They committed to him in that regard. So, you know, we'll see. Obviously, that's something that, you know, Pete DeBoer has talked about a little bit. Kelly McCrimmon, the GM, has talked about a little bit more. And maybe that's because they have somebody on the roster like Mark Stone that fits a little bit of that, you know, captain mold.
Yeah, I didn't even realize that Vegas didn't have a captain. It definitely does seem like Mark Stone would fit in. I guess either him or maybe Max Pacioretty, because he's obviously a veteran in the league who's seen a lot of success. And unlike Mark Stone, I'd be lying if I said I expected Max Pacioretty to put up the season that he ended up having this year in 2019-20. Like, he had been a solid bet for 30-40 goals, like 60 to 70 points for the Habs year in, year out. But then Patches had a down year in Montreal in 2017-18. He only had 37 points in 64 games that year. He ends up getting traded to Vegas in the summer of 2018 for a very substantial package: Thomas Tatar, Nick Suzuki, and a high pick. And unfortunately for George McPhee at the time, it didn't seem like the big bet on Pacioretty wasn't looking like it was working out. It looked like a bit of a whiff at the start. He only managed 2 points in his first 14 games as a Golden Knight. But then he turned things around. He put up a 60-point pace the rest of the way in that season, 2018-19, ended up with 40 points in 66 games for a 50.82 game pace. So could have been a lot worse. But like, going into this season, my co-host Brian and I, we felt like comfortable pegging him for a slight improvement over his 50-point pace from last year, but nothing major. It seemed like Pacioretty's biggest seasons were behind him, but of course, we were dead wrong. Pacioretty ended up putting up one of his best ever seasons this past year: 32 goals, 66 points in 71 games. It's a 76-point pace, along with a career-high 307 shots, which was third in the entire league, behind only McKinnon and Ovechkin. So do you have any sense of what changed in Pacioretty's game for him to go from looking like he was maybe starting to decline to producing as well as he ever has as a 31-year-old?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I'm kind of with you in terms of, I didn't expect this. I expected a bounce back. And to some extent, you know, he and I had a conversation at the All-Star game. He was voted, and I don't remember the exact wording on this, but it was kind of like third for like comeback player of the year or something like that at the midway point. And what was funny was he kind of took it as a backhanded compliment, almost like, well, I didn't think I had that bad of a year last year. You know, he scored 22 goals. And like you said, he, you know, he was like a 40, 50 point pace. If you put it all out there, if he was healthy all the way, certainly not what he had done, but to like call it a comeback, I think he felt, you know, maybe a little bit insulted and all that. I thought it was kind of funny. But at the same time, yeah, I don't think anybody saw, you know, what he thought. I mean, this is a career season. He got hurt right before the pause, and he's going to end up, I think it's like 1 point short of his career high, if I remember right. But all that being said, and to answer your question, I think a lot of it has to do with health. And if you go back to Montreal, he was hurt at the end of his time there. And most of that summer he had spent on the shelf. He wasn't able to skate. And I think he, you know, had the trade come in right before training camp in September. He has to move his family and do all that kind of stuff, you know, get ready for the season. And I don't know that he was fully healthy. And it was funny because he got hurt in December. And that may have been this weird blessing in disguise, because he like bumped knees and he was out for a couple of weeks, but I think it let him just get everything healthy. And from that point on, from that, you know, stretch at the end of last year into the playoffs, and then all through this year, he's been, you know, the guy that the Golden Knights thought they were acquiring and gave, you know, a $7 million, you know, dollar a year contract to. That first year, that was, starting to look like a lopsided trade. I mean, Tatar had a really good year in Montreal, and obviously this year Nick Suzuki is – emerged as a really good prospect, but it's evened out. The Golden Knights, you know, they got this year what they were expecting, and if he can stay healthy going forward, I don't know that I would expect 35 goals, but yeah, maybe he threatens between 25 and 30, and that the one thing with Max Pacioretty, and people talk about his shot, if you ever see him in person, his shot, his release is ridiculous. It just comes off his stick different. It's a snapshot that looks like, you know, the mile per hour is on it. It looks like he's winding up and whatever, but he has like no backswing to it. And, you know, it throws goalies off. It is so hard to pick up for goalies and things like that. Alex Tuch says it's the best shot, best release in the league. I'm sure you could get some argument from people, you know. Probably some Austin Matthews fans out there, right? Things like that. But that's the one thing that Max Pacioretty has that's elite. And if he's healthy and he's doing that,
yeah, he can threaten 30 goals. And just because we have time, I'll talk about this too. One of the things the Golden Knights did this year was put Max Pacioretty on the right side on the power play, his off wing, on the half wall, like in that right face-off circle. And he had never been in that spot before in Montreal. He said he's always played kind of that bumper, that middle spot. And he said he regretted never bringing it up in Montreal, because now that he's played that spot, he said that's where he needs to be. That's his home on the power play. And I do think that's another area where, you know, you look at the production and the increase, and that might be why. Yeah.
That's actually very interesting. I've never really noticed, but Pacioretty, for all those years where he was a superstar on the Habs, he never put up more than 17 power play points. I'm saying this year was a career high for him in power play points with 19, which is still not even that high compared to like the top players in the league. Like McDavid and Draisaitl were both above 40. So even if Pacioretty starts to regress even strength, imagine if he could just even moderately increase his power play point production, and he could definitely be up to a point per game player.
I mean, it's, you know, when you're looking at things like fantasy and just working in fine production and, you know, sneaky little unexpected things. Yeah, he fits on that spot. He's on a number one power play and he's featured. So with Mark Stone and you know, the other sneaky one is when they get Cody Glass back, and I'm sure we'll talk about him later on. But, you know, he's another guy that he was such a quarterback. And, you know, if he's there and Max Pacioretty's on the ice, it's a combination you look for. It's work. They have some kind of chemistry. They found it in training camp and some early season games. So just something to kind of look for, you know, down the road, really.
Yeah, it's like very exciting because I feel like with Pacioretty, he might still be a little bit underrated just because, you know, if someone looks and sees, okay, yeah, he had 66 points this year, but his last couple of years were really bad. So averaging it out, he still is probably on the decline, but you're giving lots of reasons to expect for him to be able to keep this up moving forward. And you're right, just playing with a superstar like Mark Stone obviously is going to help him to make sure he doesn't fall too far. And yeah, and if you say he has this amazing shot, well, he took 307 of them this year. So with a strong shot and throwing it so many times, yeah, you're going to expect a lot of goals to happen. So very good for the Golden Knights. And yeah, I guess it's probably the debate is still open about whether they won or lost that trade because Nick Suzuki had a great rookie season and Tatar obviously has bounced back after, wasn't he like benched for playoff games when he was in Vegas? What happened with Tatar?
Yeah, you know, Tatar, it was a weird thing. I don't know that I've ever gotten the full story on it, but it just never clicked, whether it was on ice, off ice. He just kind of never really found a role. They sort of shoehorned him in on like the third line and never really found chemistry with anybody. And they sort of tried him at times on, you know, in the top six. Reilly Smith got banged up a little bit that year and they gave Tatar a run and he just never really clicked with anybody. And then, you know, that was a weird locker room, weird is probably not the right word. Tight-knit is probably the better word. And to have somebody come in at that point in the season at the deadline with all the success they had, I think was just, you know, maybe that was a difficult thing for anybody short of like, you know, Wayne Gretzky or somebody coming into that locker. They just had such a special thing going right then that anybody that they, you know, were adding to it, it just had to click right away, and it didn't for him. So, you know, they moved on, and they felt like, you know, they felt like they had to upgrade that second line. You mentioned it, you know, early on they completely rotated over between Howell and Neal and Perron, and you know, Pacioretty was at least part of that. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely seemed like they really got a better end of that deal in terms of the present time with how Tatar was looking. And yeah, so he turned it around in Montreal. But that's good. It's nice if both teams can have a win there. And if Vegas obviously goes on to win a cup in the next couple of years, and I'm sure they won't be complaining. And we'll talk about if we think they can do it. But so moving on from Stone and Pacioretty, on the flip side, Vegas's longtime top line trio of Marchessault, William Karlsson, and Reilly Smith, they all had their career years in Vegas's inaugural season. Like in that 2017-18 miracle season, Marchessault was near a point per game. William Karlsson scored those 43 goals with that wild 23.4 shooting percentage. Reilly Smith put up 60 points in 67 games. That was an over 70 point pace. Since then, all three have dipped back down to like around 60 point paces in the subsequent two seasons. And, you know, that's solid production, right? Picking up a point in three of every four games is great. Well above what all three were producing before they came to Vegas, that's for sure. But definitely a tier or two below what they did in that first expansion year. So do you think at this point, is it fair to assume that this is the production we should be expecting from Marchessault, Karlsson, and Reilly Smith moving forward during their tenure with the Golden Knights? Or is there like one, say, of the three that you could see as most likely to maybe get back to what they did in that 2017-18 season?
I don't know that any of them are going to get close to that first season, other than maybe like what Reilly Smith did, just because he seems to be pretty close and pretty consistent all 3 years in terms of production. But I don't know if Marchessault is going to get to, you know, like a 75-point season. And I don't know if Karlsson's ever going to obviously score 43 goals or get to like a 78-point season. But I could also see both of those guys maybe having a slight tick up from where they're at. They're both, you know, Karlsson especially, if he's able to find a little bit more of a shooting touch, the assists are there. You know, I mean, if he turns into a 25 goal, you know, 35 assist guy, I don't think that's out of the question. I don't think it's out of the question for Marchessault to, you know, get to 60, 65 points, you know, approach something like that. But I don't know that either of them really, it's fair to project them, I guess, as a point per player, you know, game. I think that first year just, it snowballed, it clicked. And obviously Karlsson with everything he touched seemed to fine twine it. Right. It just, you know, it beat a goalie no matter what, between the legs or anything like that. So I do think that you know, Marchessault, Karlsson, guys like that have value. And I think, you know, maybe you can project a little bit of a tick, but I don't know that you can ever really expect, you know, if you're going to make like a fantasy lineup to have those guys and say, all right, I got a 40 goal score in William Karlsson. That's just probably expecting too much at this point.
Yeah, especially because I've noticed Karlsson's shooting has gone down since that first year. Like, he had that high shooting percentage when he scored 43 goals, but he did take 184 shots. Then the following year, he went down to 169. I guess this year, he was also pacing for around 160 or I guess he was shooting a bit more. It's just like, that was so wild that he was able to score so many goals when normally he's not even such a big shooter. But I'm curious to know also, those three that played on the same line for so long with the previous coach, they ended up getting split up at the end of the 2019-20 season. Like, new coach Pete DeBoer split them up down the stretch. Karlsson got swapped with Paul Stastny, and Stastny was centering Marchessault and Smith, and then Karlsson was moved to center Pacioretty and Stone, and then Nicolas Roy instead of Stone when Stone got hurt. What do you think triggered DeBoer to switch things up after this line has been so successful for so long?
I think part of it was injury. So William Karlsson got hurt in Buffalo the last game of Jory Gallant's coaching career. So when Pete DeBoer came aboard, he didn't have William Karlsson. I want to say it was for eight games, but that, I don't know if that number is exactly right. Whatever it was a stretch of time. And so he kind of moved guys around. And then when William Karlsson came in, it just kind of worked out, you know, that was where he slotted in. And I think Pete DeBoer said, you know, he's not married to any of the combinations, obviously, that had worked or not worked before, that, you know, it was about what was, you know, going to find chemistry at that point. And to some extent, I also think he clearly saw the combination of Pacioretty and Stone with whichever center as the number one line. And I think he saw William Karlsson as the number one center.
Oh, I see.
And so if you're going to kind of do that and experiment and kind of ultimately go that way, I think it sort of evolved to where that was the number one line. And I don't, you know, you could argue, I think more than anything, Pacioretty and Stone are the two that showed, at least, especially on paper, you look at some analytics and things like that, their chemistry, you know, their Corsi, their, you know, expected goals for and goals for, goals against, all those sorts of things are pretty much ridiculous, regardless of who's playing center. But you know, I think the way the lineup kind of slotted and the way it worked sort of at the end, you know, Pete DeBoer felt William Karlsson was the guy. And I think maybe the good thing or the you know, the flexibility, the nice thing that he has as a coach is to be able to, you know, go to a different, you know, top six center, that he can go back to Paul Stastny if he has to. He knows that Marchessault, Karlsson, and Smith have a built-in chemistry. And so if you need to shake things up, if things aren't working, then that's a line combination you can always kind of fall back on, I guess.
Right, but I guess it is interesting that the way you say it, that Karlsson, if he's the top line center, and then Schoen and Pacioretty are the top line wingers, then it makes sense to put them together. And, you know, I'm taking a look now, after Karlsson came back from that injury, he had 12 points in his final 14 games, obviously highlighted by a hat trick versus Anaheim. So I wonder if maybe that's a reason to expect more from Karlsson moving forward, if he's going to have this upgrade in wingers potentially next year, unless things obviously switch back.
Yeah, I mean, I think what will be interesting to see is how they play kind of starting fresh in this postseason, and if that's the line, in fact, that Pete DeBoer does go with. I would expect him to go with that. I don't know why he wouldn't. That seemed to be, you know, all things being equal, the combination that he preferred, you know, when everybody was healthy and they were, you know, on a roll. So I would assume that that's where he would start. And if they play well, yeah, going into next season, that's definitely something to look at.
Yeah, and I guess it's like good news for William Karlsson. And also, you know, it was good news for Paul Stastny to get on that line with Marchessault and Smith, because as of January 1st, before getting into that configuration, Stastny was in the midst of one of his worst ever seasons offensively. He only managed 16 points through his first 43 games. That's a 30-point pace if it would have continued that way all throughout an 82-game season. And this included a stretch where he was bumped from the top six completely. Cody Glass got a run on the Schoen Pacioretty line early on. And obviously, we'll talk about Glass in a minute. But then, yeah, the new year, new coach, brought back the Stastny we've grown accustomed to. As things went much better in 2020, he put up 22 points in his final 28 games to make his season total look a bit more respectable. Though his 44-point pace in the end was the lowest of his career. But yeah, what do you think was going on with Stastny that caused him to start so slow for that first half of the season, like after being such a consistent producer ever since he got to Vegas and even beforehand in St. Louis?
Yeah, so this is where, you know, I have a hard time because I don't want to be too rough, but at the same time, you know, you have to look at it, maybe the age, and you have to look at how much tread maybe is still left on those tires, I guess. The one thing that he did talk about at one point during the season was that he was maybe not fully healthy to begin with, that he was overcoming an injury from the summer and still working his way back. And so maybe that had something to do with it, but it was clear, like you pointed out statistically, but, you know, especially just watching it, he was not affecting games for the first few months. And whether he was a half step behind or just something wasn't clicking, whatever it was, I don't want to put this entirely on him, but you pay $6.5 million a year for a guy, you expect a certain amount of production.
For sure.
They were struggling at the start of the year, and offensively was part of it. And, you know, you have to look to Paul Stastny as at least, you know, a part of the reason for those struggles and things. And yeah, he got it turned around. I guess the harsh thing is, you know, if we're going to talk about stuff like salary cap and all those sorts of things, which are reality in the NHL right now, you know, it looks like that salary cap is going to stay at $81.5 million for at least next year and maybe the season after that. So somebody like Paul Stastny, who's got a pretty big contract, obviously makes more than somebody like William Karlsson, let's just say, you know, maybe he becomes vulnerable on, you know, on an off season and things like that. If they have to clear salary, they've got guys like Cody Glass waiting in the wings. There's guys, you know, further down the pipeline, if we're going to look at like Payton Krebs and one of the things that was interesting this year was after they traded for Chandler Stephenson and the way that he emerged, and he was an acquisition in early December, and he played with Schoen and Pacioretty at points and was producing it, you know, at least career numbers close to, like, you know, in his 41 games, he has 22 points with the Knights. I mean, that's like, you know, more than he had in his entire career, you know, up until then. So they might have hit, they may have hit on something. His emergence obviously allowed them to make Cody Egan expendable. And suddenly, like when you thought they maybe didn't have some depth at center, now all of a sudden maybe they have a little more depth at center than folks originally thought. And maybe that makes somebody like Paul Stastny, you know, a little bit more expendable if they, you know, try to keep Robin Lehner in the offseason or, you know, make a big run at, like, you know, there was talk at least at one point of, like, Alex Pietrangelo.
Oh, wow.
If he hit free agency, you know, maybe the Knights would be interested or to make a run at him. Obviously, this makes it tougher with the salary cap staying where it is. But if you're going to look at somebody who might be vulnerable in that regard, maybe Stastny is the guy. And I think production and age are just, you know, sort of the reality in all of this.
Yeah, it's almost like then for this playoff run, if it happens, you know, Stastny does really well, that would make him easier to trade, obviously, because he did have that slow stretch this season, which may have other teams being wary of giving him all that money for a 35-year-old player. But on the other hand, I guess if he has a good playoffs, then it's going to be harder to trade him because he's going to be considered part of the core of the team. I never considered the possibility that Stastny would get traded. I assumed he would just play out the rest of his contract. And then, you know, that would be the time when guys like Glass and Krebs maybe would be ready to step forward. But it's also a good point about Chandler Stephenson. He was always like there whenever someone got injured. It was Stephenson that took their spot in the top six.
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't know if he can replicate that. And, you know, maybe Paul Stastny just needed to get a little healthy and maybe he has a huge playoffs. And then all of a sudden he shows that he's got something left. Maybe he can be, you know, a 50 to 60 point guy again. I don't know. That's a tough projection for me to make at this point. I mean, just you're looking at age, you're kind of looking at, you know, what's sort of the norm for guys when they get to, you know, what is he, I think 34. You know, you're naturally going to slow down. It's he's a great player, but you know, it's really the elite ones that do it for as long as they do. It's just kind of natural if all their time catches up with everybody. So it'll be interesting to see what sort of production, you know, they can get with him in the playoffs, and maybe that helps with projecting his value for next season. And if he's a guy that sticks in Vegas and stays in the top six, then you know he's going to have good line mates. If he's bouncing down around the lineup, he's maybe playing third line minutes, which he did, you know, at different points in this season, then maybe he's the guy that you're not going to be able to rely on for a fantasy lineup.
Yeah, for sure. Well, yeah, he was basically doing nothing for that first stretch, but then it did seem like he had some chemistry with Marchessault and Smith. So it'll be interesting to see if he sticks with them and if he can continue, because he was putting up basically like a 60-point pace while he was with those guys. Though, of course, the person who would be most likely to rain on Stastny's parade next season in terms of offensive upside has got to be Cody Glass, the 2017 sixth overall pick, who had a really nice start to the season. He had 6 points in his first 9 games. Like we discussed, he bumped Stastny from that Stone and Pacioretty line. But that success didn't last for Glass. He ended up having what looked like a pretty tough rookie season. He only managed 6 more points in his final 30 games that he played, but interspersed with that, he missed time with a knee injury. He ended up getting demoted to the minors, and he aggravated that knee injury, I read, in the AHL All-Star game, which led him to have season-ending surgery at the start of March. So actually, before even digging into Glass's play for those 39 games that he did have with the Golden Knights, is there any update on how his injury recovery is going? Like, do we know if we should expect him to be fully healed by the next time the Golden Knights play? I guess not for this upcoming playoffs, but at least for next year?
Yeah, when we got the update from Kelly McCrimmon a few weeks ago, Cody Glass will not be available for, you know, like the postseason tournament coming up, the return to play and all of that. But he should be 100% and fully healed for next season, especially if they're, you know, expected to start in like December or maybe even January, then he would expect to be fully healed.
Okay, that's good to hear.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's pretty serious knee injury. I don't think it was anything like a sprain. If we're, you know, we never got an official word, but you know, all indications were it was an ACL. And if you watch the video, it's pretty clear the way it like bends and things like that, the ACL is probably what came into it. So, you know, it was going to take a few months and things like that, but he should be back, which, you know, again, not to belabor the point, but, you know, he's going to factor in at center in terms of depth with all those guys, Stastny, you know, Stevenson, if they re-signed Cousins, Nick Waugh, like, you know, they're suddenly pretty deep there.
Yeah, this team, I don't know. I thought expansion teams were supposed to be bad. I grew up in Ottawa. It took a long time for things to start turning around. But I guess Vegas just gets all these good centers right away.
Yeah, rigged. It's rigged, right?
Yeah.
It's like online poker. It's rigged.
Right, yeah. Well, you cover poker, so you can tell me.
Yeah, I love making the jokes about online poker, though, so.
That's funny. Well, hey, a lot of people thought that things were rigged when that penalty cost them that playoff series against San Jose, though I always would retort saying, you know, what kind of team lets in four shorthanded goals on one power play?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. It's kind of funny. Like, I was thinking back, for stuff for this and whatever, you know, the story that I've told about that is, so they scored the first goal, and I usually my routine is to go down or, you know, at some point in the third period down in the media room and make sure that I'm down there, finish my story, and then get closer to the locker room and all that. So as I was going down, they scored the second goal, and I kind of got down there and I walked into the media room, and I sort of mumbled something out loud about how I thought it was a BS penalty. And I always think back on it now, how everybody must think I was like just this complete homer, like, you know, all the Vegas reporters, like, you know, oh, you know, it's not a penalty and whatever. And, you know, and I just remember, like, seeing the replay, though, and going, oh, my gosh, if this cost them. And then it just kept, you know, like, kept happening. And I saw the third goal, and then I saw the fourth goal, and I'm like, unreal. Like, and the one thing, though, is that you knew as it was happening that was, like, a historic moment. That was going to be something that everybody remembered in hockey 20, 50, you know, maybe even 100 years from now, they're going to talk about that play.
Yeah, it's true. So, hey, that's one thing to hang their hat on. Then I was actually taking a flight somewhere the next day, and they were replaying that game in the airport. And it was wild to just watch that third period again, knowing what was going to happen. Okay, we were talking about Cody Glass. I did want to ask you, when he was healthy for that stretch, I don't know how healthy he was. I guess you could inform me on that. Like, how did he look in his first season in the big leagues? Like, do you think he'll have a chance to once again break into the top six next season, but this time for a longer stretch? Or do you think he'll need to accumulate some more experience before he could land a spot with Stone or Marchessault and bump someone like a Paul Stastny?
Yeah, so it's hard to say. So here's the thing I always try to remind myself and others with Cody Glass is, like, how young he is. And I think there's this, there's this habit people have or whatever you want to call it, to like rush everybody. And you see it and you say, oh, he was picked sixth overall. That means he's got to arrive in the NHL by this time. He's got to, you know, produce this because this guy did and this guy did. And I think it's such a disservice sometimes to guys in their development that, you know, they get there at a different rate. And maybe it's going to take Cody Glass a little bit to, you know, physically get that weight on and be a guy who can hold up for 82 games and things like that. I don't know what his impact can be next year. It'll be interesting to see, you know, obviously, since the season was paused and we haven't been around the players, I haven't seen what he looks like and how he's used the rehab, maybe to his advantage and to strengthen all parts of his body. Because that's the one area that really you can just look at right from the start and just say he's just got to continue to keep getting stronger and you know, put those pounds on, really. It might take a little bit. I don't know. The thing that I never tried to assume that I'm smarter or pretend that I'm smarter than, you know, Kelly McCrimmon and George McPhee and their staff and the folks that actually do this for a living. So I don't know where they project Cody Glass in like, you know, Paul Stastny in terms of the conversation that we had earlier. And is he ready to step in? Does that make Paul Stastny expendable because, you know, they have Cody Glass ready. They have Chandler Stevenson who can step in, and maybe Cody Glass can play on the third line. That's what's hard for me to read in terms of, you know, getting in the mind of the Golden Knights front office and what is their thinking. But I think it's fair to project that maybe at least at the end of Paul Stastny's contract, which would be after next season, that Cody Glass would be expected to kind of jump in and be ready at that point. You know, maybe that's the fair, you know, projection in to say, okay, when can he take over, you know, as a top six guy? You know, maybe after next season, and if he gets there before that, you know, then you know, good on him, and obviously maybe the Golden Knights have a player there, and maybe he's a guy for fantasy, you know, that you can keep an eye on. I think the one thing, if Cody Glass gets run on the power play, that's where he can be especially effective and maybe provide some points. He has a spot on that goal line and on the half wall where he really likes to you know, settle and quarterback and create. And the Golden Knights don't really have anybody else who can do that. It's the one trait that he has right now. And Jarrett Gallant early in the year tried to take advantage of it and utilized him there. And that's where he had his most success. It wasn't necessarily 5-on-5 early on that Cody Glass was producing. It was on that power play. So if he's able to, you know, find a home there and continue his development, you know, maybe I think it's fair for 21-22 to look at Cody Glass and say, you know, maybe he's, you know, ready for like a 50-point season or somewhere along those lines.
Right. So reading between the lines, it sounds like you're saying you didn't see enough to indicate that he's like ready to be a star just yet, but he's still young and maybe in a couple of years, that's when he'll get his opportunity and that's when you're expecting maybe something to happen.
I think that's fair. And I just think, you know, the other thing too, factoring all this is the injury. You know, it's a serious knee injury that he's coming back from. And, you know, obviously, medicine is different than even like when I was like his age and things like that, 20, you know, 25 years ago and when I'm kind of mumbling my age. you know, so it's not like he can't come back. It's not like he shouldn't come back. But I do think it's we have to be fair to him and say that that's something that he's got to overcome. And it's gonna take time. And maybe that is something that slows, you know, his development just a little bit.
Yeah, I think that's totally fair. Like we were just talking about how maybe Stastny and Pacioretty were being affected a bit by injuries. So it's also obviously reasonable to expect a young kid like Glass. It might take him a little while to get back up to speed. I guess moving on, another player that looks to have a lot of promise, but maybe suffering like from this team just being way too deep is the 18th overall pick from 2014, Alec Tuch, because he had that like fantastic sophomore season in 2018-19, where he got a long look on the second line with Pacioretty. This is like the consistent through line here, I guess. It's like when you get a chance to play with Pacioretty or Stone or someone, then you're going to do well. But like Tuch got that run before eventually getting pushed down the lineup when Stone was acquired. And people may not remember, but Tuch actually sat with 33 points through 37 games in 2018-19. So he was looking like a breakout star before he ended up getting demoted and then cooled off at the end. And then unfortunately, this past season, 2019-20, was a continuation of the second half of the previous season for Tuch as he found himself again on the third line most of the way, and he only managed 17 points in 42 games. Also, injury is a theme here. He missed significant time with a leg injury, which I'd imagine didn't help. So I guess kind of similar to my question about Glass, like first of all, how is Tuch doing health-wise? And then second of all, like do you think that the depth of the Vegas roster will keep him from like being able to repeat the numbers that he put up before, because it's just going to be so tough for him to get into the top six?
Yeah, first off, in terms of the health, he should be fine. You know, we expect, and we had heard from Pete DeBoer and Kelly McCrim that he's 100%. So I don't think that's an issue, at least going into the postseason and all of that. The Golden Knights have been pretty stingy, at least so far, in releasing the names of the guys who are participating in phase two. They've only released, I think, like 12 names, and I don't think Tuch is one of them, but that doesn't mean that he's not participating, because our understanding is that almost the entire team, if not the whole team, has been, you know, in Vegas and participating in that. So he should be fine. As far as Tuch, like I could do an hour and a half just on Tuch. Like, wow. This whole thing, because this whole situation is fascinating to me, because I think you hit the nail on the head. And what people forget is that at the trade deadline last year, Alex Tuch was the Golden Knights' leading scorer. And he absolutely 100%, like you said, was having a breakout year and looked like, you know, emerging star. And they gave him a big contract, you know, just short of $5 million a year for 7 years. And it looked like they had just absolutely robbed the Minnesota Wild, you know, to get him. And then all of a sudden, like you said, they trade for Mark Stone and there's not room in the top six for him. He bumps down to the third line and the production dips and he gets hurt. And then this year he just, you know, it was like stop start kind of the whole way. He got hurt right at the end of preseason and missed the first few games and, you know, just came back and it never really hit for him. But it's so interesting because, you know, in terms of an expansion team, he's maybe the one guy that they have that you could look at as like a young sort of prospect-ish, still emerging forward that might be, you know, an expendable, you know, valuable trade chip. I look at – so, like, the guys in Toronto that always seem to get mentioned, like Kapanen and Johansson, you know – these young guys that they're just not room for, but if they went somewhere else, they can emerge. And that's, you know, the chip that Kyle Dubas can play and maybe use. Tuch is like the closest thing the Golden Knights have to something like that, that if they're going to make like a bigger deal, I think one of the things that I've been wondering about or suspicious about is if they try to do something at goaltender, you know, if they can't afford to keep Robin Lehner, maybe they look elsewhere and maybe they look at a younger guy, you know, Thatcher Demko's name has been mentioned. I don't know why they wouldn't look at like Gorgiev with the Rangers. If the Rangers have to move one of those guys, it seems like a situation that the Knights might look at, you know, and to me, if I'm going to try to put a trade together or something like that, and I'm a scout for another team and I look up and down that roster and like, you know, who on the Golden Knights would interest me if I'm, you know, another team? Alex Tuch's name would be, if not at the top of the list, like very near it. Because I don't think anybody should give up on him. I think he's closer to the guy that we saw last year than we saw this year. And I think if he just gets a chance and some confidence and, you know, a little bit of mojo, I guess, you know, whatever that is, I think he can be a guy that is, you know, a consistent 20 to 25 goal scorer and, you know, maybe in that 50 to 60 point range. I think that's his ceiling and he's shown he can get close to it. So I don't know if he's going to get a chance with the Knights without injury. That's the most interesting thing right now.
Yeah, I guess it's just like a nice problem for this team to have. If they have this player that you're saying is capable of being like a 60-point guy and they just don't have room for him because they're just too good. And so, yeah, I guess it would make a lot of sense if they can find another team that's interested and then fill a need that they have in net, which I definitely want to get to before we're done here. I saw you wrote an article just today about Robin Lehner unveiling his newest Golden Knights themed pads. So doesn't that mean that he for sure is going to want to come to Vegas and maybe we'll give him a discount?
Absolutely. Yeah, totally right. Absolutely. He's got the pads. He's ready to go. Like, yeah, it's gotta be. I mean, that's probably the biggest question for them in all seriousness. Once it gets to the off season, you know, they've got Chandler Stephenson, Nick Cousins, who are RFAs. But Robin Lehner is really the big UFA and the one that, you know, would probably cost the most. I mean, clearly of the ones I mentioned, he would command, you know, probably in the neighborhood of like $6 million a year. You know, if somebody's going to commit to him long term for the last, you know, what this will be his fourth straight year of going to free agency. So I'm sure at this point, he's just more interested in a long term contract.
Yeah, for sure.
So it'll just be interesting, you know, with that salary cap staying where it is, if the Knights are able to afford him, and then if they're not, what direction do they go? Because they traded Malcolm Subban and they made the decision, if nothing else, they made the decision at that point, we're going a different way. with the future of our goaltending. And they've got Marc-Andre Fleury locked up. But, you know, at one point they thought or said and you know, were grooming Malcolm Subban to be the heir apparent. And they clearly gave up on that idea. They've got to start over because there's really, you know, not anybody in the pipeline, at least, that's proven that he's ready to take over, you know, at least, you know, the next coming season and challenge Marc-Andre Fleury. So whether it's a trade or a free agent acquisition or maneuvering the roster to keep Robin Lehner, they're going to have to do something at that spot. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So we might as well just keep talking about the goalies. And I did see that they signed Oscar Danks recently, but I assume that's more for like their minor league teams. He's not someone that we should be considering as an option for them.
I mean, that's how I look at it. It's a two-way deal. And, you know, maybe money forces them to look at him as the backup and give him a look. He got a game last year. He was kind of the first call up whenever they needed somebody. It seemed ahead of Garrett Sparks. So, you know, maybe that's an option, but, you know, I think Oscar Dansk is proven more to be an AHL goaltender at this point in his career than, you know, an NHL backup even. So, you know, that might be a strong projection for him. I would think they would look somewhere else, whether it's trade or free agency or you know, even on the roster in Leonard.
Yeah, that definitely makes sense. So just to put a button on it, like, so Marc-Andre Fleury, he's been the main goalie since the team was established. He had that amazing inaugural season where he had the .927 save percentage, but then he's steadily regressed. He managed only a .913 save percentage in 2018-19 and then fell again to .905 this past season. And I imagine his struggles were what caused McCrimmon to trade for Robin Lehner at the trade deadline. And Lehner, like you said, or like we've discussed, like, he's been phenomenal. Like, since he left the Sabres, he had that Vezina-nominated .930 save percentage season with the Islanders last year, had a .918 save percentage this past season with Chicago, which was maybe even more impressive when you consider the Chicago D that he was working with. And then he had only three games in Vegas before the pause, but, you know, one of them was a shutout against New Jersey. He was looking really good. So, like, what is the thought on Fleury at this point? Like, if they can't get someone like Lehner, it sounds like you're saying they would be very interested in getting him. But if they did, like, would that be to be the starter? Like, is Vegas looking to transition Fleury into being more of a backup because they're not happy with how he's been playing lately? Or what's your take right now on how Fleury fits in with the organization?